Hi guys, this is David Negrin, host of the Script Podcast and executive director of the NYC Screenwriters Collective. I'm excited to announce that we've created a Patreon campaign for the Script. Patreon is like a Kickstarter, but it allows you to give ongoing pledges every month and receive ongoing rewards. Of course, the Script Podcast will continue to be free, but we're just asking for a little help. We release 4 or 5 podcasts a month, but we'd like to do more. We'd also like to improve our audio quality and release video podcasts with rich content. So here's how you can help. Become a patron of the Script Podcast and gain access to our VIP activity feed with premium content. There, you'll be able to communicate privately with myself and my co-hosts after every podcast. You can get a packet of original screenwriting guides written exclusively for members of the NYC Screenwriters Collective. You can receive our monthly tracking board preview podcast for Hollywood insider updates on big script sales and the hottest spec screenplays to hit the market. You can get access to full on-demand video of NYC Screenwriters Collective events, lectures, and panel discussions. At the highest patron levels, you can even request the film or TV series we analyze and come on the Script yourself to analyze it. So please, check out all our rewards, join our inner circle. Become a patron of the Script Podcast at patreon.com/thescript.
It's not about control.
Stand down. It's a relationship. Based on respect. These animals are thinking, I gotta eat. I gotta hunt. I gotta.
This is the Script. The official podcast of the NYC Screenwriters Collective. Tonight, Jurassic World. We take on the dinos. Our screenwriters tonight that are with me, Jordan Rosengarten, and we've got Logan Kane, and we've got Spencer Sapienza. Logan and Spencer are our newest screenwriters at the Collective, and it's their first time on the podcast, so we're going to break them in.
That's right.
We're doing Jurassic World, guys.
Really exciting.
I mean, this is T-Rex-sized podcast.
Indominus-sized podcast.
Genetically modified podcast.
This podcast is genetically modified. This is a GMO podcast.
fully GMO. Bigger, stronger, faster.
So, first thing we do, I just want to go around. We're going to do general thoughts on the movie. And then we're going to break into the Blake Snyder beats. If anyone listening needs a breakdown of the Blake Snyder beat sheet, it's a outlining method for 3-act structure that a lot of screenwriters use. You can go to our website and find it there. But first, I'm going to start with Jordan. I want you to kick us off. What do you think of Jurassic World?
I really enjoyed this movie. I liked it. I went in with the lowest of low expectations. I saw the trailer where, I don't know, like Chris Pratt is like riding alongside velociraptors, and I was like, "What is this shit?" Like, it didn't impress me. And I almost predicted what the movie was gonna be, or what I thought it was gonna be, rather. But no, I was thoroughly entertained by this film, and we can go into the specifics moving forward.
Yeah, I really thought this trailer had it all. It was one of those damn trailers that has all the good stuff in it, and I was happily disappointed. I had high expectations for this. I did all the online work. They said that they were picking up where Jurassic Park 1 left off. Jurassic Park 2 and 3 don't exist.
Wow.
You know, that most of us
yeah, that was for the best.
Feel that way anyway.
Uh-huh.
So I was excited that they were picking up from the original, and that's a high bar. And you know, throughout this movie, I was looking for the homages to the original, the connections to the original, and I ended up somewhat satisfied. I enjoyed the movie for what it was. I have some issues. I think it was underwritten in the comedy department.
Yeah.
I think there was a lot more room for comedy, especially when you have Star-Lord in your movie.
Coming
off Guardians of the Galaxy, which
they made him
like,
way too serious.
Yeah, I mean, Guardians of the Galaxy was this fantastic action comedy, and they had the opportunity to do that here, and that it was a missed opportunity. But I don't know. We'll get into it when we get into the beats. Spencer, what did you think?
Well, I hope I'm not alone, but I actually didn't love the movie.
Okay.
Like, sitting there watching it, I enjoyed it. You know, like, whenever, I'll say this, whenever a T-Rex or a Velociraptor was on screen, I was very entertained. But
okay,
when it
so,
was,
yeah. Dino Carnage does it for you.
Yes, yes. I was, I wanted to see even more blood, actually. I don't know, but it was.
It wasn't that gruesome, actually.
Yeah, and you know, I saw the theater I was with. I guess I forgot this. It was like all children. I forgot how much kids just love dinosaurs. So they probably they kept that in mind, I'm sure. But
you know what? When we were there's a generation gap on this podcast, by the way. I'm almost 20 years older than Logan and Spencer. But when I was a kid, dinosaurs were a thing, and someone in Jurassic World said this. At the very beginning, Grace says, you know, 20 years ago, dinosaurs alone were cool, but now they went bigger and badder. And that's kind of really true. I think she was speaking to the market, the film community watching these movies. The original Jurassic Park had some really interesting visual effects, and we got to see dinosaurs walk for the first time. It was awesome.
Yeah.
And that was enough. But for this movie, expectations were higher.
Yeah, my friend who's a critic had a really, really great one line. I thought that, you know, Jurassic Park is all about how people love dinosaurs, but Jurassic World was all about how people love Jurassic Park.
Not bad.
Good summation there.
I was looking for all those connections. I'm not sure I got them as much as I wanted, but Logan, what about you? Your feelings on Jurassic Park?
Yeah, I mean, personally, I also went in with extremely low expectations, having seen the trailers and the teasers and everything. Just seemed like, you know, the lines were terrible. They're gonna go super Hollywood, probably due to the production companies and the major studios' involvement. But it really didn't feel like that when I actually went to see it. I actually watched it just this morning, so it's pretty fresh. I thought, overall, dinosaur action was amazing for an action film. Yeah. It thought so well done for the choreography. They didn't go too over the top with, I don't know, a lot of times with movies like Transformers or things that are special effects heavy or visual effects heavy, it gets really hard to even see what the hell's like going on.
Oh, that's a great comment on the Transformers films. The frame is so busy with action that you're not even sure where to look. You get confused. And then if you add on to it the second sin, which is making an action set piece too long, where you start to get bored by it.
It's boring, yep.
All of a sudden, you're putting me to sleep in the middle of a robot action movie? You got to be kidding me. You know you made a mistake. Uh-huh.
Well, that's what Michael Bay is good for now, and thank God he was not attached to this project.
Right. Oh, I should give the artist up front. The director was Colin Trevorrow. We know him from a film called Safety Not Guaranteed, which was an indie darling.
It's a good movie.
That's a big step up for him.
Yeah, he's going to be getting a lot of work after this. Like, you know, you know, listen, a good handful of directors fold, and they're not able to make their first big budget movie a success or pull it together, because there are a lot of you know, spinning wheels, and it's just hard. It's not an easy task, but when you get a guy who's able to bring it all together, it's
Was there anything online about any production difficulties with Trevorrow?
I didn't hear anything.
It seemed to me like, from what I researched it, he was pretty late in the development process. It had been going through development hell for like a decade. So he got, you know, probably some shredded story notes, just pieces of the puzzle.
Oh, well, that's the other thing. There were six credited writers on this thing. Amanda Silver, Colin Trevorrow, himself, Derek Connolly,
And the original characters by Michael Crichton.
And also the Tyrannosaurus Rex. I mean,
and
like
T-Rex himself did a rewrite.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Right? Good yeah. Velociraptor, you know.
T-Rex wanted more dialogue, and he's like, I'm walking off this movie.
Yeah. Why didn't they subtitle the Velociraptors like the apes from, you know, Planet of the Apes?
Yeah. No, that exchange that the Velociraptor and the T-Rex have at the end after they beat the Indominus, where they're just like, yeah,
okay.
We're good.
Okay, we're jumping ahead.
Yeah, spoiler alert.
Excuse me. Went straight to the end. Okay.
but also, no, I mean, the dino convos in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
I've got to say, when you're writing a action adventure fantasy, there is an art to keeping the suspension of disbelief at the right level. And it has to do with every time you do something in story that is a conceit, something that might not really happen in real life, you have to do it in steps. You have to slowly, slowly give us things that we don't believe. If you do it too quickly, all of a sudden we say, oh, that's ridiculous, and you jump the shark. And, you know, I was with you with live dinosaurs in a park, but then when the dinosaurs are talking to each other, I'm not with you. Mm-hmm. And I think for the most part of this movie, they did a decent job of escalating the plot and the rules of the universe correctly. So there were only one or two moments where I was just like, and maybe we'll get to them when we go through the beat sheet, yep, where I was like, this is ridiculous.
I mean, I thought, at least in terms of the communication and stuff like that, yeah, obviously a bit far-fetched, but I think what helped is they didn't try to explain it, you know, they didn't
that,
go...
That's yeah. Part, yeah, you make a great point. That's, if you don't try to explain it, you just go with it, mm-hmm, then that's half the battle.
Well, that was Jurassic Park 3 with the whole vocal cord thing, and they're like...
Right. But I'm
thinking about Star Wars and midichlorians. That's the worst sin of all time, is trying to explain the Force. Dude, don't do it.
No, I would say, you know, you take Jeff Goldblum's line from the first movie, you know, nature will find a way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's all I really needed in my head. It was like, all right, you know, yeah, they're communicating with each other, but I don't, you know, I get what I'm looking at, and that's my thing, is nature will find a way.
Yeah, but you know what, you bring up a good point, and maybe we'll get through this, but trying to figure out one of the issues I have with Jurassic World is it doesn't address these big themes the way Jurassic Park did. Jurassic Park talked about a couple big things. One, chaos in nature and how nature will find a way or will it abhors a vacuum, and chaos will always, you can't control it. It also talked about the ethics of genetic engineering, about whether we have the right to do something. Your scientists were so busy trying to figure out if they could, they never thought about whether they should. So Jeff Goldblum's character has all the great thematic lines,
yeah,
in the original Jurassic Park.
The best
Park.
Scene with his shirt half open while he's lounging.
That's perfect. Well, so someone said something very interesting, and it was basically, if you took Jeff Goldblum's character and Sam Neill's character, and you put them together, you get Chris Pratt in the new movie.
Hmm.
And
I'd say maybe,
no,
in a way.
No, I'm sorry about that.
You just have to. Did you just have to disagree, David? I was feeling so good about myself.
That I would like that to have been the case. That was not the case.
Do you think that was the intent, though? Because it felt a lot like, you know, that's a lot of the lines that he was delivering.
I think with your combined character variation scenario,
yeah,
that they combined Jeff Goldblum and
Richard Attenborough.
Richard Attenborough's character into Mizrani, the new owner.
That's what I thought too. Yeah.
And
he's a pretty interesting character, which I wanted to talk about.
And he wasn't as good as Attenborough or Goldblum, but he was like a little of both. And he got eaten way too soon, huh?
Yeah, kind of sucked. But
or he got blown up or something.
Yeah, the helicopter. Yeah, what I like about that character, by the way, and same thing I liked about John Hammond as a character, is that you would think that in a story where it talks about the hubris of men, and it's like, are we going to have this greedy corporate guy, and he's going to be this complete asshole, and like all he wants is money, and at the end of the day, like, these guys are just children at heart. Like, you know, yeah. If you look at John Hammond, his intentions, yeah, he's a millionaire and he's a business guy, but he's like a child. He wants to play with it because he is totally in this. He's totally genuine. He really wants to make a place where kids can come and experience animals and entertain people. And I think with Misrani, you get the same kind of vibe.
Yeah, they definitely continued that. And he kept quoting Hammond saying, we spare no expense. It's not about money. Meanwhile, Claire is I think I called her Grace earlier. I think I can't figure out. It's such a common name. Her character bugged me the whole movie because she was so vanilla,
so flat.
And Bryce Dallas Howard is a great actress and has the ability to do a lot of things besides run around in high heels.
Yeah, and then tie her coat around her waist triumphantly.
I think, I mean, we can get into how they underserved her character. I think that needs to be talked about in this podcast. But Misrani, the actor, Irfan Khan, he's a great actor.
Yep.
Yeah.
He's been in so much good stuff. I mean, he's been, he was in...
He was just an amazing Spider-Man, I think.
Namesake. Yeah, he's big now, but he was in a lot of indie stuff. The Namesake, he was in, I believe he was in the Tiger movie.
Oh, Life of Pi.
The Life of
Pi. Oh, yeah. And Slumdog, right?
Right. Yeah, he's the cop that he's telling the story to. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's great.
Great actor. So you had a lot of great acting talent in this, and...
and then there were the children.
Acting and comedic talent, too.
Oh, yeah, we have to talk about the brothers. Yeah, we'll get there. All right, guys, I want to get into the beat sheet. And as we do the beats, we can just go off in whatever directions we talk about. Opening image. Does anyone remember what the opening image was? The opening image is not necessarily the first image, but it is the thematic one of the first images that's thematic for the film. What do you guys, anyone have an opening image to this movie?
What, just having literally watched it several hours ago, what seems like it really set the theme of for the whole movie was the big dinosaur foot that slams onto the snow, and then you pull back and it's a tiny bird in front of the, you know, American home. So you get that whole, like, oh, crap, it's, like, already we're in this, and then, oh, no, never mind, it's a very tiny.
I didn't even remember that until you just said it, and I only saw it yesterday, but I remember seeing that and thinking, like, oh, no, like that's how we're starting the movie. But no, that's a good point. I totally forgot about that opening image there.
Yeah, with monster movies, you've got to use the Spielberg rule of Jaws, right, which is show the monster... wait as long as you can to show the monster. And so I think they faked us out a number of times in that respect. But they also have, you know, 8 to 10 different monsters in this movie, so they are able to tease us on each and then pay us off on each very well. So if that is your Logan, if that's your opening image, how does it match up with the closing image? Because the opening image and closing image are supposed to be a thematic bookend.
Right. And what I thought I don't know if you want to go into the closing image right now.
Yeah, right now.
Yeah, so I thought the last shot of the movie, at least, is the Tyrannosaurus Rex on the helipad. They do, like, the pan over it, then it's the landscape shot of the whole park, and he's, like, roaring back into control of the island, like it's theirs again. So I don't know if it was a contrast between, like, them being gone and they're not existent in the American suburban world or our time in humanity or whatever. I'm not really sure how grand of a theme I'm trying to go for here, but
it's a stretch. I felt that final image, the T-Rex, like we return to the island and the T-Rex is there and he's the only one and he's on the helipad and it's a dinosaur taking over technology and he looks over the empty park. I felt a little stilted. It felt like someone said, we need to have that shot in the end.
I was waiting for them to do something more along the lines of that first movie, which maybe they tried to do. It wasn't quite, you know, set up as well, where the T-Rex, you know, Jurassic Park, does the roar and that banner flies in front of him.
Absolutely.
And the banner says something like,
dinosaurs ruled the earth, I believe.
Yeah, that was so well done by Spielberg back in the day. Right? I mean, and, you know, there were several reprises. I love musical theater, so I'm going to use the word reprise often on the podcast tonight. Whenever they bring back something, an Easter egg from the original Jurassic Park movie, and the final set piece is like a total reprise of the original movie. And I don't know, when you do a reprise in musical theater or in filmmaking, you're supposed to improve upon the original and give us a surprise. And I think Jurassic World succeeded sometimes, but failed in other times. But
yeah,
you know, one of the open, you know, the, my favorite opening image came with a really great sort of screenwriting trick when the kids get, it's much later than an opening image. So, but thematically, when the kids get to the park and they're running around and the little boy's like, I want to see the dinosaurs. I want to go on a ride. And the older brother's like, no, we have to wait. They told us to wait. And he's like, I don't want to wait. And like, he's like, I'm not waiting anymore. And then he opens the double doors and we see the park. Right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's like they were talking to the audience, like, I don't want, you know, everyone wants to see the park. We want to see the park. And he's, and the little, like the little boy, and then the little boy says, I don't want to wait anymore. He opens the doors and we get this beautiful establishing shot. If there's one thing that this movie did really well, was a lot of great establishing visuals. I saw it in 3D. I don't know if you guys did, but this is one of those movies where I didn't mind. I was happy.
I as well saw it in the 3D, and at first I kind of regretted that decision. But yeah, when I got to that moment, you know, that you're talking about, David, that it seemed to like, all right, this is, we're going into the park, and it just added a little bit more, you know,
like immersiveness.
Yeah, it was a little more immersive, and although I still think that I, you know, spent way too much money on a fucking movie ticket.
I want to jump into the setup. Okay, the setup is the first act of the film, where we set up the main characters, we set up the A plot, we plant the seeds for the other stuff. I'm gonna run through some of the basics. So Zach and Gray Mitchell, these are the kids. They're off on they're being sent off by their mom to her sister's, because her sister runs Jurassic World, and they're gonna get to go to Isla Nublar to enjoy this new theme park. It's been 20 years since the original Jurassic Park.
Lucky them, right?
Yeah, awesome, right? VIP passes, you get your own little gyro mobile, whatever. We don't get to know a lot about the kids. I think Zach and Gray aren't as well painted as the original kids from Jurassic Park. You remember the original kids from Jurassic Park, the little boy, he knows everything about dinosaurs, and the girl is precocious and smart, and
well, they were with the main characters for majority of the movie as well.
And they get split up, but we got to meet them, we got to learn more about them, and it's not enough just to be cute kids, right?
It was Lexa and Tim, and if you remember that scene where you see Tim talking to Sam Neill's character, and basically you learn that, you know, Tim is into science, and you got it from that whole interaction, like, a lot about that character, where I don't feel you got as much from the boys, except for the fact that one likes girls, but, you know, which, you know...
that didn't pay off at really all later. Deep, I thought he was going to mac it later and get, like, some girl eaten by a dinosaur and then, you know, learn not to cheat on your girlfriend. That didn't get paid off at all, right?
No. Even if it's the oldest screenwriting trick in the book, I still want to see those characters be something else by the end of the movie. So, you know, if it's the brothers fighting, or if there's a disagreement, or if there's some growth they both need to do, that's just, you know, icing on the cake.
Right.
And I think it was definitely called for here, and Spencer, we still get it.
Spencer, didn't they hint at that, some kind of character arc for the brothers?
I mean, they were bonding, but...
Yeah, yeah, I mean, they embrace one another through the awesome power of dinosaurs by the end of it.
By the threat of life and death.
They have the thing about divorce, right? Together. The mom actually says to Claire at one point, she's like, the older brother is, you know, he'll be really mean if you leave them alone. We don't really see that, though.
Yeah, no, he just kind of ignores him.
Yeah, he ignores him to stare at girls without speaking to them.
Yeah.
I mean, also, that is true to life, but it's not good storytelling.
Sure, sure.
But they should be a little bit more angry at their aunt. Like, in other words, like, she can give two shits about them, and at the end of the movie, they don't spend enough time with her
for them to give two shits. That was the substitute for the Sam Neill arc. Sam Neill in Jurassic Park didn't kids.
Right.
And...
But he spent enough time with them, though. He spent enough time to kind of learn and grow. She did not.
He got stuck with them. He survived with them.
Nah, her motivation was just not to piss off her sister for a long time, basically.
Yeah, the closest thing Claire had to an arc was with the dead Brontosaurus. And when Star-Lord is stroking the Brontosaurus, and she realizes that... that they're actually animals.
Yeah, they're living things.
They're living things. They're not a commodity. Yeah. And she sheds a tear when the Brontosaurus dies. And then they have that awesome reveal of the valley with like six dead Brontosauruses.
Yeah, that was pretty powerful, actually.
Mm-hmm. That the Indominus Rex had taken care of. That was a great reveal. There was several of those. And that's just great directing because that's all like visual setup and payoffs.
And the girl sitting behind me in the theater was actually like weeping. I could hear her crying. I thought that was kind of extreme, but I mean,
dinosaurs. Yeah. You were like, "Hey, girl, chill."
Yeah, that was actually me, by the way.
Sorry, Jordan was weeping.
Yeah, a little embarrassed by that. Sorry.
That was, I mean, if there was any moment, let's talk about. Were there any moments that actually tugged heartstrings in this for you guys?
I mean, that kind of gets the closest. Like, it's like seeing a dog die or something like that. You know, they're innocents.
I have a little brother, and for me, the moment where the two brothers are alone and Claire leaves them alone and she's like, "Hold hands," and they're like, "Whatever," and then the younger brother puts out his hand to hold it, and then eventually the older brother says, "Remember that time
that he kept him safe, right?
That I kept you safe." And he said, "Yeah, you made a battle axe out of a ruler and a paper plate." He's like, "I'll always keep you safe." Mm-hmm. And then the little brother's like, "Yeah, but you won't always be around," because he had said earlier, "I'm leaving for college."
Right.
And then he said, "Yeah, but we're brothers. We always come back to each other." That was a good moment for me, like emotionally. I have a little brother. I feel that way about him too.
And I really enjoyed seeing them like explore the original park. Like I was having fun with them. Like they were clearly enjoying that, and I was enjoying them enjoy it.
That was extremely nostalgic. Yeah.
That nostalgic bit where they go through the old park. Like that almost brought me to tears just because. You know, of the emotion that's going into, like, me remembering Jurassic Park, me seeing it. And also, when they say, oh, it's a 1992, Jeep Wrangler. And that's when Jurassic Park came out in 1992.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember seeing that movie with my dad. It's weird because this movie does play a lot on nostalgia, yet it makes it work. It's not using it for, it makes it work within the story. And that's why it's so brilliant. It's in a scene like that.
There's several... This is a credit to the director because... There's several websites out there that tracked all the Easter eggs from the original movie to the new movie.
Oh wow!
And you know a director doesn't get any credit from the studio for taking time to put Easter eggs in his movie.
Right.
Right. He gets credit for being on budget, on time, and great action set pieces that put asses in seats. Right. And so there's websites with a ton of Easter eggs. But from the beginning, we get even in the setup after we find out Claire is all business and she's selling
the brand
the brand to sponsors. Uh-huh. They've come up with a new hybrid dinosaur, Indominus Rex, pretty cool name, that they designed. the pavilion, the central pavilion that they explore in the beginning has some has the virtual reality dinosaurs, no, like the holographic dinosaurs that pays off later. That was actually a great payoff when they're running later on and he sets off a hologram that distracts a raptor. Mm-hmm. But that pavilion looks like the original pavilion. Everything in Jurassic World looked like the same park, but bigger and badder. The headquarters, the HQ, the computer HQ was like a bigger and badder control room than the original. And we even have the actor, the guy from New Girl wearing the Jurassic Park t-shirt.
That was great.
And that reference. What did you think about that?
I thought he was...
Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I thought he was really funny. And, you know, like we were saying before, Chris Pratt didn't really get to flex his comedy muscles much in this. No. So I really appreciated when he was on screen. The only thing I'd say is the woman at the desk next to him, her name's Lauren Lapkus. She's a hilarious comedian I've known for a while, and she didn't really get to do anything funny either.
They hired two really funny people. It's a blockbuster movie, so there's no actor in this. Yeah, we got Irfan Khan. He's an incredible dramatic actor. We've got two incredible comedic actors.
Yeah,
and you're just not giving them. You're not giving them. Mm-hmm. Time to shine. They have that one funny moment at the end when he goes to kiss her.
Oh, that was so funny.
Like, and she's like, I have a boyfriend. She's like, he's like, you don't really talk, you never say anything. Uh-huh. She's like, I'm at work.
Yeah.
I kind of like that. I thought there was enough from, I think his name is Jake Johnson, the New Girls guy.
Yeah.
I think there was enough from him, you know, as far as I was concerned, where it was like, it reminded me of when you had Nedry, the computer technician, the first movie, who was played by, what the hell's his name from Seinfeld?
It's Newman.
Whatever his name is irrelevant,
Just Newman.
You know, and it's like, he's a comedic actor as well. It wasn't really funny in that role, but there were some one-liners that you're like, okay, he's, you know.
But Newman's personality sold that role. The fact that he was money-grubbing and that he was arrogant and he was the computer guy. So that was helpful. Yeah.
Speaking of references back to the original, they even did like a you have a messy workspace bit to Jake Johnson, which they do to to Newman.
Ah, nice catch. But they clean up your workspace, right?
Yeah. They couldn't be more different as characters, though.
That's true.
Yeah,
he has a little arc. Because at one point there's a boat that's saving everybody. And he's like, no, I need to stay and work out the control room. So
right.
I want to move forward on the beats. Theme stated. So this is a really hard one because it's a line from the movie that represents the theme of the movie. And as I said earlier, I think thematically, I'm not sure where Jurassic World succeeded. But does anyone pick up a line? The theme stated during the setup. Usually the first 15 minutes. Sometimes it's spoken by a minor character. Sometimes a major character. Anyone have a theme stated line?
I got one, but I'm not sure if it was like the exact. It might not be the same line that you're thinking of, but it was by Masrani when he's flying the helicopter. He basically tells Claire about, you know, unless you give up. I forget the exact line, but he says, if you can't accept the fact that you're not in control, like, you won't live a happy life or something like that.
I wrote that down. The key to a happy life is to accept that you are never actually in control.
Okay.
Yeah, that's definitely one of them. I liked that one.
And the one that I actually thought was the one is the where he says, the point of the park is to show how small we really are, and you can't put a price on that.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that, I mean, he was kind of laying down some heavy-handed philosophy for that whole ride.
Yeah, I mean, it's also riding on, standing on the thematic shoulders of the original film instead of reestablishing them theirself. He's saying chaos, he's using all the Jeff Goldblum themes. The one area, and so Logan, I like your line, it's definitely a theme stated. Another line that I liked was, you do understand these are actual animals, right? Let's show a little compassion. That was Star-Lord Owen to Claire. And that actually is an arc for her, is that she ends up caring about the animals. But it's not like that.
Good point.
it's not like the biggest arc of the movie, but I think all of those are good. Anybody else have any other themes stated?
I do remember there was a moment where Star-Lord says that, genetically, modifying a dinosaur is probably a bad idea. He doesn't say it exactly like that. It was kind of edited that way in the trailer. But in that scene where they're basically saying, like, you went out and just made a new dinosaur, like, without understanding the implications of what, that means and what dinosaurs are in there. And to me, that was basically the idea of this film is, like, okay, we got the park working. We understand these animals. Now let's create something that we completely don't understand. And let's just start all over again and fuck everything up, Like, that was basically, in a nutshell, what he was saying.
And this is... Let's get to this, and this is the problem I have with Claire. Because she is in charge of this park. She is obviously... She dresses like a badass businesswoman. She's supposed to be smart as a whip.
Mm-hmm.
And she seems completely oblivious to the fact that controlling the animals in this park is going to be the biggest... challenge and has existential implications. In fact, at one point when she enlists Owen to check out the new dinosaur, he asks some really smart questions. They do a great job of making Owen sound like a really great dinosaur expert and tracking guy, and he says, well, this dinosaur hasn't been socialized. All it knows, it's been alone, so it's going to be angry. It doesn't know where it is in the food chain. And she's like, oh, so you want us to set up a play date for it?
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
And that's such a disservice to her character. She is supposed to be smart, intelligent. She runs a Jurassic World, and she doesn't understand the basic social requirements to make the dinosaurs animals happy. Yeah. Making her the person who's ignorant to the dinosaurs was not a good choice. I mean, they had this insurance guy, a lawyer in the original Jurassic Park, who was the one who played the role of, let's make money, we don't need, let's be ignorant to the science stuff.
Yeah.
And
it's a job. It's just a job for her, really, right? I mean, that's what we're led to understand from her character, is that this is just her job. It's just like running any other theme park, and
we don't know what she wants. What does she want in life? To become the head of Jurassic World, you must have been a badass at something.
Yeah, she probably worked her way up from some other companies, and then she applied for a job, and they hired her, and she worked her way up that chain. So she's definitely not stupid, but I don't think she necessarily understands Jurassic World, because she understands as much as she can, but she doesn't know about the genetic engineering department. Everything's department-wise, right? Yeah.
She doesn't have a passion for it.
Right, exactly.
But we don't know enough about her to know what she has a passion for or not.
Yeah.
And we never learn enough about her, but we get she's beautiful. We get she's in charge. They use this really interesting... She's in her business outfit the entire film. And I want to hear... I mean, we're four guys on a podcast... But, she looks great in those pumps the whole movie. She's running around in heels. But I'm a guy, and I know you can't run in heels for 2 hours, especially running from dinosaurs.
Under those circumstances. That got a lot of heat in the media. That was like a huge issue for feminists, that she wore the heels. And what I came to find out is that was the actress's choice, and that
is
the director...
That true?
Yeah, the director had made, kept as they're filming, saying, like, are you sure you want to do it? And she insisted that she keep the heels on.
Wow. So she thought it kept her in character. Actors are always doing that kind of a thing to stay, method acting, to try to help her stay in character. But I'm sure if her feet got sore, they let her do a take with them off, or they had some stand-in pumps or whatever that were cushioned. I think it was part of this heightened universe that this story is in.
Right.
Frankly, I will tell you what I think it was. I mean, yeah, maybe Bryce Dallas Howard wanted to use it, but they spent a bunch of time with her in heels for that final payoff when she saves Star-Lord from the pterodactyl with the gun. Yeah. Right? Oh, yeah. That great iconic shot of a woman in a sexy business suit with a gun shooting a pterodactyl in her high heels. Yeah. And the high heels made that shot, actually. Yeah. So it's like they needed to keep him on for that shot. And then we get the kiss.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like, which was totally not earned. You know, we yeah. didn't feel like they cared about each other by that point, but it was so
heat of the moment.
Action movie, dramatic. Mm-hmm. It was kind of fun.
I would give it a pass though, because you do establish some history between them, and granted, if I was really nitpicking for some reason, I'm not in a nitpicking mood with this movie, just because it wasn't enough to upset me. And I think that I was like, okay, they went on a date, we established that. They're like, they're in this moment, I get it. Give her a kiss. Great. Perfect. I'm in. Like, to me, it didn't bother me that much where I was like, what the fuck, you know?
Well, at least it wasn't at the end. That would have been ten times more exactly. cliche.
Well, yeah,
Spencer. No, I was going to say, absolutely. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I think it, you know, I was going to basically agree that, you know, I thought she was underserved, to use your word, David. I think that's perfect. But like, you know, by the end, you're kind of like, okay, she did basically save the day, whatever. But I think that points to a larger problem where none of the characters really had huge arcs.
Nah.
Typical for an action movie, though.
It's pretty shallow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can we talk about Vincent D'Onofrio?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I love Vincent D'Onofrio.
I love him, too.
Why can't he go on, like, a little bit of a diet and not have, like, a paunch? No, he's a brilliant actor. And then in the middle, like, I can't stop staring at his pot belly in this movie.
Maybe
he was clearly bulking up for Kingpin. Yeah, exactly. There we go.
Yeah. Oh, because he's cast as Kingpin? All right. Yeah, actually, yeah. He was great, like, when he was speaking. But that B story of Engine and militarizing the Raptors, did you guys buy that?
No.
Yeah, that's where it fell apart for me, to be honest. Like, if I, you know, that's where I started to get a little concerned. So we could talk about that, because like his character and the motivation and him and Dr. Wu. Can we talk about Dr. Wu?
Oh, I can't believe they turned B.D. Wong into a bad guy.
That was so... honestly, I forgot that even happened because I liked most of this movie, but that was a point where I was like, oh, come on.
That is a betrayal.
And it was so unnecessary. They just kind of like threw it in at the end, and then he just disappears on a helicopter.
Yeah, I think it was more in service of a sequel. They're like, all right, how are we gonna make this happen?
The entire ending of that B story with... D'Onofrio and B.D. Wong's characters, they steal the embryos and they take them somewhere else. Okay, sequel, we got it. But turning Dr. Wu into like a power-hungry scientist after he was like this surrogate father character, and he loved the dinosaurs in the original Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
I did not. That was a terrible choice.
Yeah. First of all, why would any of the employees from Jurassic Park want to be involved in Jurassic Park?
You make a great point.
Yeah. He's Dr. Frankenstein, man.
Yeah. Second of all, I mean, even if they gave him a boatload of cash and like, all right, come back and do this. All right, fine, I get that, but like, I don't know. You didn't get any idea that he was this greedy, money hungry guy. He's a scientist. He wants to discover and figure out and. I mean, I could believe that he would create a genetically modified dinosaur. I totally believe that.
Yeah, that's fine.
But I would believe that he would want to do it more for the sake of science, not for money.
Can we talk about the new dinosaur?
Actually, the least interesting aspect of this movie was the new dinosaur for me. I actually thought that it was just a vehicle to get us through Jurassic World. And what's funny is that the characters are not even strong. I'm not saying it was a character movie by any means. I'm just saying that... The dinosaur itself, it could have looked like anything. It could look like King Kong.
This is a dinosaur movie.
Yeah.
You
need to feature a dinosaur. So in the original Jurassic Park, we already, the American audience knew about Tyrannosaurus Rex, and they introduced us to Velociraptor. So the raptors were this new antagonist, and they were like mini T-Rexes that were fast and they were smart.
Yeah.
So now we go to Jurassic World. Let's not talk about what they used in movie 2 and 3. But you go to Jurassic World, and you have to create basically a new antagonist. But the new dinosaur, I keep forgetting its name. It's so hilarious.
Indominus Rex.
Indominus
Rex. He's essentially a T-Rex on steroids with spikes and a couple special powers.
Uh-huh.
Right? It's just like a bigger T-Rex. And at the end...
a smart T-Rex.
Yeah.
It reminds me of...
sort of smart, but
reminds me
still...
of Jason X. Like, Jason goes to space and they upgrade him.
What happened there? What's the parallel to Jason in space?
That, you know, same villain, just superpowered. They take him to space and he gets something that makes him more lethal.
Right. Right. I liked the explanations of the genetic modifications where they used
the chameleon and the frog.
Right. They used the cuttlefish genes to adapt to change color, and then the tree frogs to modulate temperature. That was cool, and that made sense because Jurassic Park has always talked about genetic modification. The only reason these dinosaurs are here is because of gene science. Yeah. So I'm glad that we got a little bit of that. I just think I can't even say Indominus Rex was underserved as a bad guy, because we had one moment where I thought it was going to get good, where they talk about Indominus not being socialized correctly, and Owen is like, he's figuring out where he is on the food chain, and you don't want him to figure it out. And then we find out he's killing brontosauruses. I thought there was going to be a little story arc for Indominus, figuring out that he was a freak, essentially, amongst all these other dinosaurs. That would have been really interesting.
Yeah, sure, like King Kong almost.
Exactly, right? What would the parallel have been there?
I mean, you can also say that you can tell when, like, something like an animal is unsocialized and, you know, it's skittish. They didn't show any of that, you know, where it might be scared of anything.
Yeah.
Like, a dog, where if a dog is totally unsocialized and it bites people and it attacks other dogs, it also exhibits that, you know, like, fear of everything, kind of, and they didn't show that, at least. It would have added another dimension.
This animal is victimized. They created it, they kept it in a cage, and it got out, it got angry, and they never talk about that. They just turn him into a one-dimensional villain who just wants to eat everybody and kill everything. So that was unfortunate.
Well, I think that parallels the thing we were saying about D'Onofrio, where, you know, it's kind of, we expect the dinosaurs to, like, run rampant because they're animals, and it goes back to the hubris of the scientists and their questionable motives. But then when D'Onofrio is kind of a flat villain, you know, we got to look somewhere, and I think,
Yeah, the original setup of Star-Lord's character being teaming up with the raptors, turning the raptors who were originally the enemies of the original film into allies for this film was great. That's a great reversal. We also, by the end of this, T-Rex becomes an ally. Remember Claire in the third act, Claire goes and gets the T-Rex to fight Indominus, which is fantastic.
But how does she know that was going to happen?
Know what's going to happen?
Oh,
that the T-Rex wouldn't just freaking go the other way and, like, just take a crap
and
or
how
something.
How do they know when they let the Indominus they let the raptors out, they're going to go hunting? And how do they, you know, you've got to suspend disbelief on this a little bit. Let me take a minute, guys, because we're jumping all over the place. I want to run really quickly through our second act and some of the other beats. I really feel the catalyst of the movie is when Indominus Rex escapes.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. Absolutely.
That kicks us off. There's a bunch of stuff before that where, Owen is asked to take a look at Indominus by Claire, where we find out, you know, they had been on a date once, and I'm like, oh geez, really? Like, it's the rekindling thing. Like, why can't they just be new to each other? That's a lot more interesting to me when they don't know each other, and he's the Marine and she's the businesswoman, and I don't know. But
you could see like a first interaction between these characters, you know, like the first time Han Solo meets Princess Leia,
Yeah, it's so much more interesting than the rekindling stuff, even though you got a couple good jokes out of the first date thing. So Indominus escapes, eats a slow guy.
Right? Yeah, he had no chance, huh?
Do not be slow and work in Jurassic World, okay? You guys, you should know this by now, okay? Mm-hmm. And she also eats the fat guy, too. Don't be fat in Jurassic World. And we get some really good stuff. Every time Owen's on screen fighting dinosaurs, it's great. He puts oil on himself to hide his smell. He knows stuff.
Yeah,
they did a good job
clever.
Of making him awesome.
Mm-hmm.
They just didn't do a good enough job of making him funny. Because we are definitely comparing him to his work on Community and his work on in Guardians. And we know he can be funny. And you know what? With five screenwriters on this thing and the budget of this movie, you can at least pay someone to do a comedy pass and have some decent jokes.
Yeah.
And in the banter in between the action set pieces was really weak. So that was one of my... one of the things I thought was just really lazy about the screenwriting on this movie. We get the B story set up, the Hoskins and the military goal of testing out the raptors.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote that we get a reprise of the ostrich-like dinos running in the field. That's a visual from the original movie.
Yep.
I liked that. The boys are worried about the parents getting a divorce.
Now, would you say that's like their storyline catalyst? In a way, or no? Like, or would it be maybe when the brother chooses to go off a trail, or is that like a break?
Oh, if you want to break their C story into three acts.
I was just wondering because I thought that might have been actually the B story, but since they actually were the ones that connected with
there was a lot more meat to the boys' personal story and the boys getting lost and surviving, so that is closer to a B story. Than say the romantic relationship between Owen and Claire, but the trouble I have in designating the B story is that the military B story is the one that that affects the A story the most.
Yeah.
The third act, the low point. And the break into three are surrounded by the military taking over the
they're the bad guys.
The control room and deciding that we're gonna send the raptors after Indomitable Indominus. Okay.
The Indomitables.
I'm trying to get to a midpoint. There's a lot of great fun in games. So many dino set pieces. The Stegosauruses and the kayaks. The travel bubbles, those were so cool, right?
Yeah, that whole sequence was great. And I think, you know, that harkened back to the original where they're on that tour and the power goes out and the T-Rex attacks them the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
But it was even though it was basically the same sequence, I thought, it was still really fun. And that was, you know, probably the best scene that those boys had together.
Yeah, and it was pretty well done. It was better than just a T-Rex nose getting stuck in the sunroof, right?
Well, that's also an allusion to Jurassic Park as well,
totally,
like the two kids.
Totally. The travel bubble set piece that we get the so let's see. Okay, then for me, do you guys have any idea what the midpoint is? Where do the stakes raise? Where is the escalation of this script?
I thought it was when the kids are reunited with Claire and Owen. It's pretty much halfway, but it's also at the same time when the aviary had opened up and they were attacking all the people.
That's later, man. I think that's more around the low point. To me, the biggest low point is when the birdcage opens and the birds attack Jurassic World and everybody's dying and... to me, that's the big low point because the Jurassic Park is now not just offline, it's under attack, you know, Alfred Hitchcock bird style, right? You know, on steroids. So to me, that was sort of the low point. And the reuniting of all four characters actually is a good signal that we're about to get into the third act. Midpoint, something earlier. I'm looking for earlier.
How about Owen and Claire setting out together to find the kids?
That's what I think. That's the closest thing I think. So yeah, I'm pretty sure that's the middle. That's the midpoint. When Grace asks Owen to go get her nephews with her, and then they go into the valley, because there isn't there's a couple of small steps that escalate during the bad guys close in there. The Kylosaurus fights Indominus. Right, the Kylosaurus, the thing with the tail, that was pretty awesome.
Oh yeah.
That was right. Sweet. We get another dino set piece during the bad guys close in. We get Indominus versus the boys in the spheres.
Mm-hmm.
Then we at that point we finally start to see the entire Indominus Rex. That's second half of the second act, we're starting to fully see the monster, and I think that's good directing, because they kept it from us long enough.
Mm-hmm.
I love how when the boys are in the gyrosphere and they say, oh, I count one dinosaur, two dinosaurs, and then the kid says, oh, three. Yeah. You see the reflection.
Yeah.
That was beautifully directed, I think. I mean, where it's just that suspense is there. And then even there, you don't see the entire dinosaur. You just see the teeth coming through.
And we're like, here he is again.
Yep.
Although, at first, I thought it was a regular T-Rex. And that's the trouble when you have a new monster who looks a lot like the old monster. And it took away from... Because I kept waiting for T-Rex to appear in this movie.
Yeah.
And I thought that was the moment. And then I was like, oh, I guess he's not going to be in the movie. And then finally it pays off in the third act, which was cool because he ends up being a pseudo-good guy.
Yeah,
which is another great reversal.
Yeah.
Then more bad guys close in. The boys have a nice laugh when they escape on the gyroscope. Owen finds the huge brontosaurus that's been beaten up by the Indominus, and that's where Claire has her arc where they cry for the dead brontosaurus, and we see the whole valley of dead brontosaurus. Brontosauri, that was awesome. I thought that was a real wow visual, and I was happy I was in a 3D movie. Vincent D'Onofrio is taking over the raptors. Grace and Owen track the boys down. Grace is still wearing high heels. The boys are on the run, trying to go to safety, and then the boys end up in the old pavilion from Jurassic Park 1. Right, and they even pick up the flag, right?
Yep.
From When Dinosaurs Ruled the World.
And like a T-Rex bone or something to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it may even be like the same T-Rex bone the little boy from the first movie did. I wrote down a note at this point that I didn't care enough about these kids. Like I liked the little younger one at that point. Because they start to, they pick up the, remember they jump start the old van and the goggles, and they rebuild one of the SUVs together. That actually was like, oh look, brother bonding moment. They're building car together, and that's when they finally have that good. It leads to that conversation they have later on. So we started to get some more character development of the boys at that point, which was nice. Sorry guys, I just want to get to the third act. C story, Hoskins wants to let loose the raptors to kill the ingenious Rex. Ms. Ronnie gets in his helicopter with a minigun to go after the dinosaur. Okay, that's like a jump the shark moment for me. What did you guys think about that? They set up that he can fly a helicopter earlier. Hammond couldn't fly a helicopter.
Yeah, but an inexperienced pilot for that mission, it's like they really didn't have any. He even says like they don't have anybody else, or it has to be me.
Right, there's like a half-assed thing where it's like all the military guys are dead, so I guess he has to fly it.
Yeah, it really it really did. You really didn't have to fly it.
They didn't make it seem like he was a last resort. Like if they actually made it seem like that, it would have been like, oh crap, he's the one. Instead, it's like he's choosing to do it, and so nobody's saying no.
For me, the jumping the shark was any time they used, and this is what Blake Snyder calls double mumbo jumbo. When anytime they had big military weapons versus a dinosaur, I was like, this is getting ridiculous. Later in the third act, when they're using rocket launchers against the dinosaur, I'm like, this is just over the top. And that's where the suspension of disbelief. I bought everything up until then. I bought all this dinosaur stuff. I bought all the special powers of impenetrable Rex. You know, I bought all this stuff, right? But then the rocket launchers versus dinosaurs, that's a bad pulp movie.
And it also relates to, like, what they want these raptors to be, the weapons. Like, what were they intending on? Like, it's literally like strapping lasers to their heads. Like,
right, dino lasers, right.
Yeah. Do you think Vincent D'Onofrio ever went to Siegfried and Roy and was like, can you train me tigers?
Right.
All I could think about was them selling the raptors to, like, Dr. Evil to put lasers on
my head.
At one point, he has a little piece of exposition of, like, yeah, you know, predator drones can't go into caves and they can be hacked.
God.
Velociraptors are obviously the future of weaponry. Right.
It's very convenient.
There hasn't been a movie where velociraptors have not eaten their owner. Okay?
Yeah.
Have you even seen the first Jurassic Park movie?
Yeah. Well, he's a character when I first, you know, saw the first interaction between D'Onofrio and Chris Pratt and started to get a hint of this, like, idea of, like, the secret project for the raptors. I'm like, all right, this is going to be incredibly stupid. Like, it's just, I don't know which writer was responsible for that part, but that was the worst part. If you took that out.
It needed to come down to our main character's ingenuity. You beat dinosaurs with ingenuity, not technology. Right. That's boring to us.
Yeah, against the odds, not with the odds.
Right. At one point, I think Owen says, we have an M134 around here. Why don't we blow this thing to bits? I'm like, A, that would end the movie really quick.
Yeah.
B, what kind of gun is that? I want to see you shoot that thing. But it, you know, all of a sudden we're in a military movie, not a dinosaur movie. Claire and Star-Lord are running around trying to get away from inefficient Rex, and at one point, Claire actually hides behind Owen, like, gets behind him physically. And you're like, okay, now this is... any chance of her being a strong female protagonist is taken away. It gets somewhat brought back when she saves him from the pterodactyl later, but I was like, oh, this is just...
even the boys are like... They keep talking about how cool... he is.
Oh, yeah.
Owen is.
Oh, your boyfriend's a badass.
Yeah, exactly.
That was a good line. I like that line.
Yeah. Good line, though.
But what was your point, Spencer?
Oh, no, just that, like, you know, we wanted to see the arc of the nephews and the aunt growing together and of her becoming, like, a badass bitch and taking down some dinosaurs. And instead, it's kind of just like, if we hide behind Star-Lord long enough, he'll save us, right?
Yeah, it's right. And she never takes over... Until she goes and gets the T-Rex.
Sure, yes. She has a couple moments.
She is not active.
Yeah.
She's along for the ride.
Then I thought they could have shown that as being a bit of a more drastic decision, because she goes in and, yeah, she's letting a T-Rex essentially chase her to the fight, but they don't show it, you know, get even close and, like, you know, snap at her or anything. There's no feeling.
What we needed in this was Owen... to get disabled at some point. Okay, we need him to get hurt and her take the reins. Her learn the lessons he's taught her, him being like a mentor of how to deal with real animals, and then she pets a raptor and soothes a raptor and saves the day, and she protects the boys, and she finds the T-Rex and solves the problem. But because Owen is like the main character throughout the whole thing, he never gets injured and he's always in charge, and so her character never gets fully explored. Anybody have a low point for the movie? What was our all is lost moment?
I had trouble with that one, but I want to hear what you guys had to say.
Spencer?
The first thing that comes to mind, I don't know, is the raptors turning on them and then siding with, what is it, you know, impervious
Impervious Rex. Yeah. Uh-huh. I thought that too. That was a great reveal, by the way, when they start speaking to each other and you're like, oh, this thing is part raptor. That was good screenwriting because
good twist there.
Great twist because of all the mythology that we are asked to believe, that one piece of information that its DNA structure is hidden and it could be made up of unlimited types of animals from tree frog to cuttlefish to actual raptor. That was a great twist. So I liked that. And yeah, you're right. That raised the stakes. I don't know if that's the all is lost, because the all is lost is supposed to be, you know, existential threat. It makes the main character just want to pack up and go home. It's a moment where if we had not embarked on this journey at all in the first place, we would have been better off. Anybody else? All is lost?
Yeah, I thought it was actually, when I first thought about the all is lost, I thought it was the raptors turning sides. And then later, I thought it was when they were trapped by the raptors and Owen uses his, you know, voodoo powers, his mind control, and gets them to realize he is the alpha again. But that just didn't fit with the whole, like, Dark Knight of the Soul
that was third act awesomeness. Like, that was, you know, when he become re-alphas himself, that was cool. But that was definitely third act. That's him saving the day, you know, in that third act. You know, one of the things you look for in All Is Lost is a brush with death, a whiff of death. And in a movie like this, usually somebody should die, right? And we have Ms. Rani dying.
Yeah, in the helicopter scene with all the flying dinosaurs. Yes.
When the pterodactyls get free, Ms. Rani dies. Then the pterodactyls attack Jurassic World, and they're picking up and dropping people left and right. That was a little violent to me. Did you guys?
I totally agree. And that assistant who has, like, she's in it for 10 seconds.
God. She gets it so bad.
Yeah, she has such a gruesome death. I'm like, what did she, like, it was awesome. I loved that huge sea thing, but it was still like, what did she do to deserve that?
That seemed really violent to me. And the fact that they did it to a female character seemed a little, it was off-putting. Because they didn't just pick her up and drop her. They picked her up and dropped her several times, drowned her. It almost seemed like a sexual assault or something like that. It was really uncalled for. But
yeah. But she did lose track of the kids, so it's just fine.
She was bad at her job, so she gets eaten.
Yeah. Right. Well, she. Yeah. Okay. I'll be the feminist, and she doesn't have the maternal skills. She's not good for anything. You should just kill her. Right?
I honestly thought they were gonna go in the direction of, like, she was gonna be in the mouth of the pterodactyl when the thing snapped it, and then she would, you know, like, fly off and.
Yeah, I thought she was going to get away. No, the Mosasaurus ate her and the pterodactyl.
I was kind of confused. I'm like, but wait, where is she?
Yeah. I didn't like that for only one reason. It takes away from the surprise at the very end. If that wasn't there, if that didn't happen with the sea dinosaur
the Mosasaurus.
Coming up. And, yeah, I would have been a lot more shocked, but I kind of saw it coming at the end.
I'm going to disagree with you. I think that was a great red herring because you know the Mosasaurus has to come back.
It's too on the nose, man. I think the red herring was when you actually see it as an exhibit, you know? I think that, but I know what I'm saying. Like,
to me, I was waiting for that thing to come back, and when it ate her, I was like, oh, that's the return of it. So I wasn't expecting it in the third
act. Oh, like a false.
Okay, that makes sense.
Logan
okay.
And Spencer, we vote on that.
Oh, man, it's tough to say.
Did its earlier appearance make you think it wasn't coming back, or did it telegraph it that it was coming back?
You know, I'd agree that I thought the whole set piece around its introduction definitely warranted at least one comeback.
Yes.
But I was happy to see it twice because that was one of the few times where I was totally uncynical and I was just like an 8-year-old enjoying a dinosaur doing badass stuff.
Me too. That was awesome. And it was yet another dinosaur, a new monster for our movie.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought... Logan, what did you think about the surprise at the end? Were you surprised that it at the end it was Raptor, T-Rex, and Mosasaurus versus
Yeah.
I mean, sure. I think it was a perfect way to end the indomitable snowman guy, but no,
yeah, it was like we say no genetically modified dinosaurs here.
I would say, great to see it in that other scene where it comes up and snatches the pterodactyl. They had that in the trailer as well. But it did make me predict that it was going to come right when they knock it into that fence.
Okay, so
when it hit that fence, I'm like, oh, it's going to get eaten.
Okay, you agree with thing. Jordan then that it telegraphed
so, but it. It may have not telegraphed it to somebody not as aware of those things. I'm not sure.
We're all expert moviegoers. The C story crosses. this is why the Huskins, the D'Onofrio story to me is more like a traditional B story because it impacts the A story. N-Gen arrives, takes over the control room. Actually, they reprise that helicopter shot approaching the island. You know that the original helicopter shot from Jurassic Park heading to the island.
Sure.
It's a beautiful shot, but this time the bad guys are in it. So I actually didn't like that reprise. The kids, Grayson and Owen, are reunited. Right? So if our All is Lost... we didn't finish the All is Lost conversation. But to me, the All is Lost was the combination of Mizrani getting killed and the birds attacking Jurassic World and the assistant being killed. Like that, the assistant dying was kind of the brush of death for me, the whiff of death. But then we get some new information. We get the military guys say, you know what, we've got a plan with the Raptors, and Star-Lord clocks D'Onofrio, and he's like, "You're not going to do that with my babies." And 3 minutes later, he's like, "All right, I'm on board for this plan." Did that make sense to you?
I guess he just felt like he was the only one who could do it, and if he didn't, then everyone was going to die anyways.
That is the no.
But dude, not
that does not that is, it just doesn't make sense. He betrays his you know these animals who, and they have a moment where he introduces them to the kids and says this one's named Blue and this one's named Delta and I'm like, wait, you just signed up to send them as bait for interracial Rex, you know, like I'm running out of I words. I don't have anything else. But he is interracial because he has like multiple genes. Okay, anyway.
Yeah,
I get it.
he just signed their death warrant. He's using them as bait, and then he's telling us he's naming them. So I don't know. But that's our break into three, right, guys?
To be honest, I had it just way too late. I thought it was just because Gray says the line, "We need more teeth," and it had that aha moment, and she goes to get. The T-Rex, obviously, that's like literally right before the end of the movie.
That's part of the third act. Yeah, no, it's part of the finale. Yeah,
which is basically them ending up where all the embryos are being taken out of in the lab.
Yeah, I mean, Spencer, you want to take a crack at what's the break into three here? What is the final mission, and when does the main character decide to go on it?
Well, I think all signs point towards the kids and Owen and Claire coming together, but I don't know what like their revelation would be. Yeah, I'm at a loss.
There isn't much of a revelation. There isn't, you know, usually there's new information. The closest thing is that the engine people show up and say, "Hey, we're in charge here, and the goal is no longer to survive on this island. The goal is to kill Indominus." And so the mission has changed, and Star-Lord signs up for it, because you know what? We need a badass action finale, right? My only problem is that they don't get the kids and Claire off that island. You know, they're sitting in an ambulance. And Owen sets off with his troop of raptors to go kick some ass. Let's talk about the third act, guys. How did you feel about the ending?
I thought it definitely... The ending in this movie definitely mimics, or at least attempts to, play homage to the finale of Jurassic Park. You have the three of them, right? Our three characters running away from velociraptors.
Yeah.
And that's the last scene. That's the last act of the last scene. I'm sorry, the last scene of the last act of Jurassic Park, where they're running away from the velociraptors, these vicious animals. And you know, in here we start off in the lab. The raptors are coming through, and then they're brought outside by the raptors, and they're
we start off with the raptors on our side, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Owen's got his troop of raptors. Then when they finally catch up. And he's got the army with him. It's like guns, missile launchers, raptors that are extremely well trained, going after Indominus. And once they get there, the raptors start talking to Indominus. They have a little powwow, and they're like, you know, dude, aren't you like Cousin Mike? Yeah, Cousin Mike. Yeah, let's turn things around. And now there's a new alpha, which is a story point that they did establish earlier. The idea of of Owen establishing himself as the alpha, and so they will follow him, and then Indominus takes over as the alpha. So I did like that, and it was, like we said, it was a great twist. But then it's dinosaur versus army, and the army's losing.
Right.
Dinosaur returns to the park because they were all the way out in the middle of the forest. And, yeah. You know, it seemed a little contrived that they want to finish the set piece at the pavilion so that it parallels the original movie. But, right. You know, whatevs.
You got to get another shot of Jamba Juice in the background.
Yeah. Starbucks. Yeah. Margaritaville.
Yeah, I loved all that stuff, man. That to me was my favorite, just seeing all these different brands. Like, it was a real resort. And, you know, seeing a Starbucks and a Pandora. Sure. And all these
at one point, she says it. She says... We decided it's going to be Indominus Rex or
Verizon.
Brought to you by Verizon.
Oh, my God. Yeah. They could have called it the Prius hybrid. Yeah.
While making money. Yeah.
Right, right.
So you get the third act, you get another dino set piece with the raptors loose, and he's on a motorcycle. That seemed a little jumping the shark to me. The raptors eat the ACU, the military guys. A raptor gets shot with a missile launcher. Remember the raptor who's looking back at him and he's like, "Hey, you're my like pseudo dad, and I'm thinking about making you my alpha again. I'm thinking of coming back home." And boom, he gets blown up with a missile launcher.
I swear to God,
that was a note from a producer somewhere. I want to see his raptor child blown up by a missile launcher.
Yeah, but are raptors made out of like, I don't know. I mean, they're wearing Kevlar or something because there was only three of them, right?
Yeah, four.
There were four? Okay, yeah. I thought there were three. Oh, okay, because we end up with three, and I was just making sure that raptor did not survive that rocket launcher straight to the face.
Oh, okay, keep doing the raptor count. Okay, good.
Yeah, because if, you know, if that was the case, where, you know, I would not be able to believe that a raptor would survive that.
All right, so let's finish up this third act thing. I had a note here that after after the raptors return to the base and start attacking Grace and the boys,
or you know, Claire?
Claire and the boys in their ambulance. I made a note. I was like, I'm already tired of action set pieces here. I'm kind of tired of what's going on here. Could this movie please end? Then the boys shock the raptor. Owen pulls up in his motorcycle. Who does he think he is pulling up in a motorcycle in a dinosaur movie? Again, it's like, what is he, Tom Cruise?
Indiana Jones.
Then we get the BD Wong and Haskell, you know, and D'Onofrio are going to steal the embryos. All right. You had to put that in to set up the sequel, fine, but it was totally out of place for the end of the movie.
Yeah. DB Wong just does a mustache twirling thing.
Oh man. Sadly, he's a great actor too. A guy from New Girl tries to kiss the nerdy HQ girl. That was hilarious. That was a funny joke. Finally, we get some funny from those two actors.
How funny was it when Owen, Chris Pratt's character, gets all pissed and swipes all of his dinosaur toys off of the off of his desk? It was like his reaction. He's great.
Yeah.
good setup where the young boy uses the hologram of the small spitting dinosaur, which is a reprise from Jurassic Park 1. The raptors surround Owen in the pavilion, just like Jurassic Park 1, and Indominus shows up, and it's raptors versus Indominus, same as Jurassic Park 1, except Owen's got a gun this time, and he's shooting at him with bullets, because the bullets are going to make all the difference.
Yeah, but that was a cool gun, though. At least he got to carry a really cool gun. That really helped.
Rifle or something. It looked like a pea shooter. And then the younger brother has the idea of, we need more teeth. And that was cool. That was a good line.
Yeah, yeah.
And Claire goes to get something in her heels still. You notice, you know, she still looks great in that outfit with the heels. And the final set piece is... She opens Paddock 9. It's T-Rex becomes, again, an ally in this sense, because it's T-Rex against Indomitable, and it...
And it's the first time we see him in the entire movie. True. If you notice, there's one time where they're going to the Tyrannosaurus exhibit, and there's kind of a fake-out, where as soon as you're ready to see the T-Rex, he turns around and picks up the
Right, and they're all watching him eat something. Yeah.
It's like in the background... Which is kind of a commentary on this whole thing, which is like, you have a freaking Tyrannosaurus Rex in front of you, and you're talking to your mom on your cell phone.
Which is funny.
Uh-huh.
But again, if Indomitable didn't look so much like a T-Rex, it would have been a much bigger reveal. You know?
Right.
Mm.
So we've got the little raptor saves the T-Rex, because it's raptor plus T-Rex versus Indominus. And the little raptor actually saves the T-Rex, and they have a little moment at the end where T-Rex thanks him. It's like there's all this like interracial dinosaur drama, you know.
I mean, that's one thing I was like not truly buying, but I kind of just let it go. Is the fact that these are essentially more prehistoric than crocodiles. Like, you wouldn't see a crocodile be like, "Yeah, I got you, bro. Like, thanks."
That's a little bit too much science. All right.
Yeah.
All right, fine. Nice.
Yeah, whoa there, Michael Crichton.
Yeah, let's keep the DNA out of this.
Fair enough.
And we get the great finale where the Mamasaurus eats Indominus. It takes three regular, ungenetically modified dinosaurs to eat the new one, and it's pretty good. It's a pretty good ending. And they don't dwell too long after that. They have a little bit of aftermath. The parents reunite with the boys. Grace and Owen have a little moment with their silhouette. So what do we do now? We probably stick together for survival. Okay.
We stick together for the sequel. We
probably stick together. Yeah, I mean, come on. Let's get an... I would have... they can make it out at the end. That would have been fine. This movie throws back to a lot of classic, like, action romance stuff. There was a lot of great Steven Spielberg-esque stuff in this.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
A lot of there's so much visuals that reminded me of Spielberg. Even the score, they used some of John Williams' score, but even the new score was a lot was very reminiscent of Spielberg.
Michael Giacchino did I think that's how you pronounce his name, correct? He did an amazing job at the score, because I was actually listening to it today on my way home, and I was thinking, like, like you said, David, the moments that were not the theme even sounded Spielbergian, like sounded something from like E.T. or something from that era, and I was like, that's so brilliant, you know,
because it brings us there. And visually, there was a lot of great Spielberg. When he does action, he does these great reveals, and the director, he definitely took a page out of that book. There was one shot, remember when the ACU guys find Indominus's tracker, and they're like, oh, he ripped it out, and then the blood drips on him, and they all look up. That was very Spielbergian. Yep. Actually, reminded me of Predator a lot. Like,
yeah.
So all right. So we hit all the beats, guys, and we're getting to the end of our podcast. So I want to just go around quick and say, what were your final thoughts, positive and negative?
Okay, so I will just restate. I love this movie.
I loved it.
I thought it was a lot of fun. I don't think it was deep. I don't think it was groundbreaking. I had a good time. I went there. I enjoyed myself. I walked out with a smile, and that's all you could really ask for in a summer movie. But breaking that down is, you know, I think that it works aside from the script. I don't think the script is inherently smart. I think that there are a few things, like the fact that we have a functional park, you know, and we're dealing again with the hubris of man. But I would say that it's more of the directing. It's the little things. It's the way it's presented that really sells it. It's how they how we're shown Jurassic World. The characters aren't really deep, but they don't really need to be.
I disagree. And it moves along. It's one of the biggest failings of the movie. But go ahead.
All right. But let me finish. But it moves. But I would say the pacing of the film is where its strength is for me, and I think that's why I'm able to kind of sweep all the other crap under the rug, because I'm like, you know what. I'll go along with it. It's not insulting my intelligence, mm-hmm. and it's entertaining me. So I don't have to really nitpick here and there where I would if it was some other director where we're just spending an hour watching two animals kick each other's ass and buildings blowing up.
Yeah, it was a long
up.
Movie. It was 2 hours and 10, and it moved. So
it moved. Mm-hmm. It was fast. I thought I was out of there in like 60
and
minutes.
And we didn't get Man of Steel, where the last 40 minutes is action set pieces that are putting you to sleep. It was managed well. The action and the drama ratio was managed well.
Yep, and that last act, if it was with another director, like I said, with the Velociraptors and Tyrannosaurus fighting the Indominus Rex, that could have lasted for 15 minutes if it was like Peter Jackson or if it was like
Zack Snyder.
Exactly. And you know, so the fact that it was contained and it moved at a very fast
and kept
pace,
surprising us. Little twist. Some of the twists were not as original as they could be, but it kept it going, yeah.
Sure. So I it was a well-paced movie. Definitely script problems. Definitely very shallow characters. But again, they didn't insult me. It didn't feel like, oh, really? Like, I wasn't rolling my eyes. It was just, I wish I could get a little bit more. I wish I could know these people more and give a little bit more of a shit about them. It would have helped immensely.
Yeah.
So that's where I stand. I enjoyed myself.
It's funny. I agree with a lot of what he had to say, with what Jordan just had to say. But I still left a little cold. I thought it was only okay. Because, you know, the pace was there, so I didn't get too upset with any plot holes, or I didn't get too bored by any of the kind of flat characters. And, you know, Colin Trevorrow clearly, like, knew what he was doing with the action. He directed the hell out of the dinosaur sequences. I just hope that next time, you know, he really lets the actors flex a little more. And, you know, bring Jeff Goldblum back.
Thank you.
That's what it means. Yeah.
Logan.
I mean, I actually was pleasantly surprised by this movie. Like I said at the beginning, it seemed like it was going to be just total crap based on the trailer, and I just didn't have any faith in it.
And the previous two sequels.
Yes, exactly. But I really thought they did an excellent job establishing the world in a new way. And also, it's very rare to get that kind of nostalgia from a movie, and for them to do it in a nice way, in the way that they did it, I feel like I didn't get that from watching, like, I don't know, the second Star Wars trilogy. I guess there wasn't that much time for me to develop as much nostalgia, but I thought they did a great job of putting in those little pieces, and it did make me feel like, you know, remember those times when I first saw it and saw it over again and fell in love with those characters. So I gotta give it to them for that, but obviously lacking character depth. I thought pretty weak arc for the lead actress, so a lot of problems there. But you know, they got a chance to either screw it up again or do
best
better on the sequel.
Best moment of the movie. What was the best moment?
I really liked, for some odd reason, the fight scene with the gyrosphere and those armored dinosaurs, and just the boys escaping. I thought that was really well done,
and it kind of it's like slapping the guy with his tail. The fact that even a much smaller dinosaur is an animal and says, like, all right, you're coming after me, I'll fight you my way, even though you're like a genetically modified, that was great.
It actually gave him a little bit of somebody to fight against, and also I loved how they kind of set up the gyrosphere with Jimmy Fallon. It was pretty funny. Universal, like, that's what they do. Universal
and
Studios.
And Fallon gets spit on with the green goo from the original movie, and he's like, that stuff will paralyze you. Wait, is this real? And then he passes out. That was a setup. That's how Newman dies in the first movie, remember?
Yeah, very true.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Awesome, Logan. All right, my opinion is, you know, I was entertained, but let down. I felt... for some reason, I was thinking a lot about the second Star Trek reboot movie, Star Trek Into Darkness, where they had the whole mythology of Khan to play with and then sort of wasted it a lot. I felt like Jurassic World had such a great mythology, and they took the time to put in all the Easter eggs and the homages to the original, but didn't innovate over the mythology that much. You know, didn't give us new themes to talk about. Didn't just pick up the old themes and do them in a new way. The action was fine. The main character was all right. We didn't have anyone nearly as entertaining as Jeff Goldblum. The one female character was weak. The relationship between the brothers grew eventually. That was nice to have. But overall, I just feel like there's a lot of opportunity missed, so I was disappointed. But was I entertained? Of course, yeah. The pacing was well directed. I think, my favorite moment, I think it was still that moment with the boys where that C story of their parents getting divorced comes up, and we get to see them for a moment in, be brothers, and despite being chased by dinosaurs, and then they rebuild that car. It's like they stole a car and go joyriding. It was like that was character development in the middle of a dinosaur.
Yeah, that was definitely one of the more genuine moments in the movie.
The hardest writing challenge I think that they succeeded at on this film was escalating the monsters at the right rate. Showing us a new dinosaur, teasing a new dinosaur, not showing it, and then paying it off later. Teasing a new dinosaur, not paying it off. We started with raptors. We started with Indominus, and then we don't pay him off till later. Then we get raptors. Then we get the Chirosaurus with the big tail. And then we get the pterodactyls that turn out to be pretty aggressive. Then we get the Mamosaurus, the Momosaurus, or the big water dinosaur, the sea dinosaur, and then we get T-Rex at the end. And so, when your drama is primarily external, doling out the escalation of those external antagonisms is really important in a film. And that's where the previous sequels failed like miserably, because they just didn't know how to handle the dino sequences, the dino set pieces. And that's what this movie is all about. Guys, thanks so much for being on. This script is produced by Jordan Rosengarten and David Negrin. You can email us, fan mail us, hate mail us, comments, questions, or proclamations to scriptfeed@gmail.com. Join our Facebook page, our Google+ page, by searching for NYC Screenwriters Collective. You can also follow us on Twitter, @ScriptFeed. If you live in New York City, please sign up for one of our workshops at meetup.com under NYC Screenwriters Collective, or go to our website at screenwriterscollective.org.